Maayong aga sa inyo tanan. Sa mga maaten sa aton nga prosesyon, sa aton nga kada parokya nga mga representatives, ang Knights of the Altar, ang lay ministers, lay associations, kag ang mabitbit sa inyong estandarte, magplastar na kita sa gwa sa katedral, kag pangitaan ninyo inyong vicariate, kag within 10 minutes, ma-start ang aton nga prosesyon. Sa magaupod sa aton prosesyon, plastar na kita sa gwa. Ang mga bitbit sa estandarte sa kada parokya, magtipo na sa gwa sa katedral. Kag pangitaan ninyo ang inyong bekaryato. Sa liwat, ang mga attend sa prosesyon, ang Knights of the Altar, lay ministers, kag mabitbit sa estandarte, palihog, proceed sa gwa sa katedral. Sa liwat, ginapangabay ang maa-intra o maa-upod sa prosesyon, palihog magagto na sa gwa sa tubang sang katedral, ang magabit-bit sa inyo estandarte, mga lay ministers kag acolytes.
Hello, hello. Hello, palihog lang. Kung tagiyas ang silakyan sa Goa ka parking, pwede ito na na yung mapagwa ng 2981 ng plate number. Pwede ito na pagwa na, palihog lang ha. Kung pwede. Ang tagiyas ang silakyan ng 2981 plate number, pwede pagawa ng silakyan yung palihog lang. Thank you, kid.
in your dwelling place forever. Take me to the place where you are. I just want to be with you. I want to be where you are, dwelling in your presence, feasting at your table, and surrounded by your glory. In your presence you are. Oh my God, you are my strength and my song. And when I'm in your presence, though I'm weak, you're always strong. I just want to be where dwelling place forever. Take me to the place where you are. I just want to be, I just want to be with you. I just want to be, I just want to be.
Darkness. You. living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you. I look upon my life and realize at last, within myself there's nothing I can do. Myself completely, Lord, to you. Take my life, a living sacrifice. I know that it's the least that I can do. Make my life a living sacrifice.
The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 8 that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. Father God, we love You, and we believe that we are called according to Your purposes and plans. Use the circumstances of our lives for Your glory.
Thank you.
began in 1572 with the coming of the Augustinian prelates from Oton, Iloilo, who built their convent in the town of Pinalbaga. The Philippines at that time was still under the Diocese of Mexico. In August 14, 1595, Pope Clement
finding myself at a loss,
the Holy Name of Jesus, Diocese of Cebu, separating it from the Diocese of Mexico. Negros Occidental became part of this diocese, and with the coming of the new missionaries, more visitas and parishes were created. The Augustinian Recollect Fathers returned to the island in 1848 and established more than 30 parishes in Western Visayas. With this new development, the spiritual administration of Negros Occidental was transferred to the Diocese of Salog, now Haro, in 1865. At this time, Bacolod was also made the center of the religious administration of the whole island of Negros in 1875. The San Sebastian Church was constructed. When the revolution broke out in 1898, the Recollect friars have no choice but to abandon the 36 parishes and numerous visitas under their care, leaving only a few Filipino secular clergy to take care of the local church. Of the 210 parishes in Western Visayas, only 26 had resident priests, and of the 36 parishes and chaplaincies in Negros Occidental, only 7 had resident priests. This crisis on the scarcity of the priests forced the apostolic delegate Ambrose Agios to convoke the Synod of Manila in 1909. Among its decisions were the formation of more Filipino priests and the creation of additional dioceses. Immediately, 3 dioceses were created by the Pope. In a census in 1918, it was found that nearly 1/3 of the Aglipayans in the Philippines were in Negros Occidental, with its own diocese and bishop located in Valladolid. Petitions were made to create a diocese for Negros Occidental to counteract the growing number of Aglipayans. But due to the scarcity of priests, nothing happened until July 15, 1932, when Pope Pius XI issued a bull creating the Diocese of Bacolod. This resulted to the separation of Negros Oriental from Cebu and Negros Occidental from Haro as a new diocese. However, it was only on May 4, 1933 that Bishop Guglielmo Piani, the papal delegate, issued the order of execution, and on the 19th of May, Haro Bishop James McCloskey was named apostolic administrator. On June 23, 1933, Father Casimiro Liadok, the 40-year-old vicar forlain of Albay, was appointed the first bishop of Bacolod. As directed by Bishop McCloskey, and in accordance with the specific instructions of Pope Pius XI, the Recollect Fathers in Negros Occidental were transferred to Negros Oriental and Romblon, and were replaced with Filipino priests from Negros Oriental. Bishop Liadok was consecrated bishop on September 16, 1933, in Nueva Cáceres, and took the See of Bacolod on October 14. He consecrated his attention to the rebuilding of many parishes, training more priests, and fighting the growing secularism and strong Protestantism in schools due to the expansion of Protestant-owned Silliman College in Dumaguete. 3 Catholic educational institutions in the diocese were established: La Consolacion College, Colegio de Santa Rita, San Carlos, and Santa Teresita Academy in Silay, all of which were exclusive schools for girls. LCC was expanded with the opening of a school for boys in La Carlota, while the Recollects established a boys' school, the Colegio de Santo Tomas in San Carlos, in 1940. He tried to get Ateneo de Manila, San Beda, La Concordia College, and La Salle College to Bacolod, but failed.
The site for Ateneo was later donated for the Sacred Heart Seminary, which was constructed in 1948. Bishop Liadoc believed in prayer and work. He asked the Carmelites to open a monastery here in 1935, but they came only in 1946. He asked the Redemptorists to increase their missions in the diocese, and they did, starting in 1940. On December 29, 1950, the Redemptorist House was founded in Bacolod. Bishop Liadoc became extremely ill in 1949, and his Vicar General, Monsignor Flaviano Ariola, was appointed Apostolic Administrator, sede vacante when it was clear that he would no longer recover. He died on September 22, 1951 in Manila and was buried at the San Sebastian Cathedral in Bacolod. Due to his work, membership in Aglipayanism dropped considerably from 474,845 in 1918 to only 119,401 in 1948, a drop from 34% to 8% of all Aglipayans. He succeeded in having catechism in public schools, and with the expansion of Catholic schools, stemmed the tide of anti-Catholicism. On March 16, 1952, Bishop Manuel Yap of Capiz was appointed Bishop of Bacolod. This Cebuano biblical scholar was only in Capiz for 10 months when he was installed Bishop of Bacolod on May 15, 1952. Bishop Yap fought and succeeded against government attempts to impose the compulsory reading of the unexpurgated work of Jose Rizal in Catholic schools. In close coordination with his Vicar General, Monsignor Antonio Y. Fortich, Catholic mass movements were organized, the Concilio de Cristianidad, the Barangay San Virgen, and Samaria. It was the time of resurgence of devotions and the re-evangelization of the upper and lower classes of the local church. The Catholic action began by Bishop Liadoc became widespread, especially in schools, as a response to the growing secularism and anti-Catholic sentiments in leading public schools. He strengthened the Sacred Heart Seminary, giving most of his own money for its expansion and upkeep. He established the Catechetical Institute in 1955, and use the Catholic Charities food aid for children's snacks during summer catechism classes. Early in his administration, Bishop Yap gave his support to Father Hector Mauri, a Jesuit who was organizing labor unions in farms and commercial establishments. There was much opposition, but the education of workers continued with the support of the diocese. Cooperatives were tried, but most had failed. Social action and pastoral work began. On June 12, 1955, the Diocese of Dumaguete was created. Parishes from Escalante of Negros Occidental and Negros Oriental and Sequijor formed the new diocese. On October 24, 1955, Monsignor Epifanio Sorban, an Army War chaplain and death march survivor, was consecrated and installed Bishop of Dumaguete. Many of the priests from Negros Oriental returned while others remained in the Diocese of Bacolod. In 1956, Bishop Yap had the San Sebastian Cathedral renovated through keeping most of its interiors intact and had it consecrated. The changes brought about by the Vatican Council II in 1965 was first met with opposition by some and skepticism by others. The altars were moved towards the congregation as the priest now faced the faithful during Mass. Latin Mass, however, still prevailed, though English came in slowly. As the Barangay San Virgen and Samaria began to make many tasks in the church, Hiligaynon slowly entered into the liturgy. Bishop Yap died on October 16, 1966 and was buried at the Bacolod Cathedral. His Vicar General and Rector of San Sebastian, Monsignor Antonio Fortich, was designated apostolic administrator and later was appointed the third bishop of Bacolod by Rome. On February 17, 1967, right after he was ordained bishop, he began his office as pastor of the Diocese of Bacolod at the San Sebastian Cathedral. It was the time of great ferment in the world. Even the seminaries were swept by student activism and teach-ins. By the time Bishop Fortich took over, many of the changes in the church had filtered down to the local churches. Among the most significant change was the encyclical issued by Pope Paul VI regarding the role of the church in the modern world, which revolutionized the thinking in social work. The bishop had to walk the tightrope as the new thought, like Christians for National Liberation and Liberation Theology, competed for the hearts and minds of both clergy and laity. A few priests embraced the CNI and even communist ideology, where many were influenced by the new theology as a Christian approach to confront the twin evils of feudalism and capitalism, and the rising alienation of the poor from the church. There was a battle between the right and the left, and the bishop had to keep the church within the path of modernization and activism in the light of the church's social doctrines. Negros Occidental had always been the focus of many social and political controversies because of its socio-economic conditions. In 1968, the Diocese of Bacolod held a pastoral congress to assess these conditions and to define the role of the church in addressing oppressive situations in the light of the papal encyclicals. Bishop Fortich issued a pastoral letter that provided the new direction of the diocese in relation to the endemic problems of Negros. In implementing the points in the pastoral letter, mass organization of cooperatives and labor unions, even in commercial establishments, were initiated. The Kaoswagan Project and the Dakungkogon Rice and Sugar Cooperative Mill were organized in the hinterlands of Kabangkalan. Taking Care, other Catholic-related organizations, including schools, embarked on socio-economic projects and social activism to directly address the issue of poverty, oppressive wages, labor exploitation, land grabbing, forest denudation, and political terrorism. The preferential option for the poor guided the pastoral work of the diocese. The new thrust of the diocese was not without cost. Big landowners, political kingpins, and their tentacles of power instigated massive attacks against the person of Bishop Fortich and the clergy, accusing them of being communists or allies and protectors of the communists, the National Democratic Front, and the New People's Army. Members of the clergy were subjected to many forms of harassment, including the charge of murder and immortality. Bishop Fortich earned the moniker as Commander Tony. Several rich families, many of them members of the Corsilio and Catholic organizations, withdrew support from the diocese and the parishes. Others turned indifferent, but the poor, the victims of injustice, the persecuted, the marginalized, and the masses found shelter in the diocese, which provided legal, social, and even financial assistance and counseling. The Social Action Office was created. The clergy, both diocese and religious, and the majority of the faithful rallied behind Bishop Fortich despite continuous media attacks against them. Lost in the din of social activism were the pastoral works that the bishop initiated. More mass-based religious organizations were organized. The active participation of the faithful in church activities multiplied. Changes in pastoral relationships improved. More young people entered the seminary. More parishes were created. The San Sebastian Cathedral was renovated in 1976. the Bishop's Palace, now known as the Bishop's House. When Pope John Paul II decided to come to Bacolod in February 1981, the visit was interpreted as support of the Holy Father for his work and that of the clergy in his speech. The Pope referred to the work of the diocese in trying to defuse the eruption of the social volcano that was Negros. Bishop Fortich coined the term. Because of his work for social justice, threats to life of Bishop Fortich were frequent that one evening, a grenade was lodged at the Domus Dei, his residence, after the bishop's house was burned in 1985 under mysterious circumstances. The bishop's house was rehabilitated and expanded and rebuilt almost a year after. On August 11, 1988, Bishop Fortich retired after reaching the mandatory retirement age of 75. At this time, the Diocese of Bacolod was also divided into three dioceses, Bacolod, Cabangcalan, and San Carlos. Replacing Bishop Fortich was Bishop Camilo D. Gregorio, a native of Nueva Ecija, who took over the See of Bacolod on July 27, 1989. Bishop Camilo tried to fill the shoes of Bishop Fortich in socio-economic projects and in social and pastoral activities, as well as his direct rapport with the masses. But he had a different perspective of his role as a bishop of Bacolod. The conditions and challenges in the diocese did not fit. Slowly, differences in the social and pastoral direction of the diocese began to widen and fluster. Most of the clergy, church workers, and the faithful home to the pastoral work under the Bishop Fortich believed that the new bishop was not addressing the issues of the diocese and its people. The dissonance between clergy and bishop eventually broke out into the open in the form of public issues that dealt on the administration of the diocese. The pastoral work and personal adequacy of Bishop Gregorio. Division among the clergy affected the laity, polarizing the pastors and faithful in the end. The Holy Father thought it wise to accept the resignation of Bishop Gregorio on September 2, 2000. Yet his brief term was not without its fruits. His support for renewal movements led to their significant and vigorous growth, while the Pope John Paul II Institute for Marriage and Family was initiated during his term. He also initiated inland wine caravans for the promotion of peaceful election and for the protection of life. With the resignation of Bishop Gregorio, the Holy Father designated Bishop Navarra, then Bishop of the Diocese of Cabangcalan, as Apostolic Administrator, and later appointed as the fifth Bishop of Bacolod on May 24, 2001, and was installed on July 19 on the same year. It was under his episcopate that the Diocese of Bacolod hosted the National World Youth Day in 2003. After studying the problems of the diocese, he convoked the Second Diocesan Synod on January 20, 2002 that involved the long process of consultation on the grassroots or parish level. After the parish consultation and issues laid by the Synod had been completed, the delegates deliberated from October 2004 to January 18, 2005. It was the biggest assembly, 182 delegates that included 89 members of the diocesan clergy, 26 religious men and women, 64 lay persons and representatives of lay associations and special bodies. On January 20, 2005, Bishop Navarra promulgated the 115 decrees which covered a wide range of subjects that intend to transform the diocese and the faithful. The Synod defined and transformed and renewed diocese through the pastoral thrust at Church of the Poor, embracing Jesus' spirituality through a sense of communion and renewed integral faith formation and expressed in the basic ecclesial communities. To begin the process of these historic decisions, he strengthened the pastoral, the lay formation, and social action centers. A new rectory, a three-story building, was constructed beside the cathedral and was inaugurated on January 20, 2007. On March 30, 2007, he initiated the celebration of the Diamond Jubilee of the diocese. With his experiences as the first bishop of Kabangkalan, he was aware of the problems of the province. He spoke strongly against illegal logging and environmental degradation and led protest caravans to call public attention to the dangers to the environment. He is one bishop who did not mince with his words in his protest against the RH law, with the support of the faithful of the diocese. Reaching 75 on his birthday last January 22, 2014, he handed in his resignation to Rome as Bishop of Bacolod, but stayed on as its pastor until the proclamation of a new bishop on May 24, 2016. Today, August 9, 2016, the Diocese of Bacolod marks the new era in its life as a church with a new leadership of Bishop Patricio A. Buzon Didi, then Bishop of Kabangkalan, now to be installed as its sixth bishop and pastor.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit. Palihog maglingkod ang tanan. Sa sining abahin, aton karon pamatian ang halangdon nga presidente sa Catholic Bishops Conference of the Philippines, Archbishop Socrates Villegas, sa iya mensahe para sa mga tumuloo sa Diocese ng Bacolod.
Your Excellencies, the Archbishops and Bishops of the Philippines, most particularly Bishop Navarra, our Bishop Emeritus, the religious sisters and brothers, brother priests, the honorable government officials and brothers and sisters in Christ. I can speak on behalf of all the bishops that when we are called, appointed as bishops, or sent to diocese as local ordinaries, the question always is, why me? When a bishop is sent to a diocese, he is sent as a minister of mysteries. And he begins his mission not understanding why he is being sent to a diocese, not understanding the reason behind the decision, but only saying, ad sum, fiat, let it be done to me according to your will. Bishop Pat Buson comes to the Diocese of Bacolod as a minister of mysteries. He doesn't know why he's being sent here. We don't know why he's being sent here. But God knows. And God certainly knows that at this time in the pilgrimage of Bacolod, Bishop Pat Buson is the good shepherd that this church needs. To you, our dear people in the Diocese of Bacolod, you can only understand the mission of being Pat if you look at him as a man carrying the mysteries of the Good Shepherd. He is not the president of a corporation. He is not the chairman of an NGO. He comes here as a man of mystery, representing Christ the Head, representing Christ the Good Shepherd. He is being sent here in order to dispense with the mysteries of the Lord. It is a mysterious mission because it is a mission that will be undertaken under the shadow of the cross. It is a mission that will be undertaken with the promise of the resurrection. Brothers and sisters in Christ, you have a new bishop. Please accept him in faith. He comes to you carrying the mysteries of the Lord. He comes to you carrying the mysteries of the mission of the church. He comes to you carrying the mysteries of the blessings, the graces that the Lord has entrusted to his church. You will not be able to understand his mission if you have no faith. And it is only in the light of faith that Bishop Pat's mission can be understood. Understood temporarily, because truth to tell, my dear brothers and sisters, the mission of a bishop, the dignity of a bishop, the role of a bishop, the love of the Lord for a bishop cannot be fully understood here on earth. Because if you would understand the bishop's role here on earth, you would die. Because your mind is too small, your heart is too small to contain the immensity of that mysterious mission. The work of Bishop Pat, as the work of Bishop Navarra, as the work of every bishop, as the work of the Bishop of Rome, cannot be fully understood here on earth. It can only be understood in heaven, because the work of a bishop is to bring the mysteries of heaven to earth. I come from the Archdiocese of Lingge and Dagupan. And in our province, when it rains, our farmers tell us, the heavens come down to kiss the earth. On the installation of Bishop Pat as the sixth bishop of Bacolod, it rained because the heavens came down to kiss the soil. And you can tell your children and your grandchildren that every time you see a bishop, heaven comes down to us to kiss us, to caress us, because your bishop is the face of the mercy of God for Bacolod.
Pagkatapos ng mensahe, igapakita ni Reverendo Padre Segundo Tsuwa III, Chancellor ng Diocese ng Bacolod, ang Apostolic Letter sa kay Archbishop Socrates Villegas, ang presider sa siniing canonical installation, dayon sa mga obispo, sa Board of Consultors ng Dioceses, sa mga kaparian, kasa mga tumuloo. Paliog magtindog ang tanan. Sa paghangyo ni Archbishop Villegas, ang Apostolic Letter pagabasaon sang Chancellor para sa igdulungog sang tanan. Una sa lingwahe nga Latin, kagdayon sa lingwahe nga English. Palihog maglingkod ang tanan.
As the presider of this canonical installation, it is my responsibility to require that the Apostolic Letter from the Holy See be read.
Franciscus Episcopus Servus Servorum Dei, Venerabili Fratri Patricio Abelia Buzon, Episcopo Actenus Cabancalensi, Electo Sacrorum Antistiti but Diocesis Bacolodensis, Salutem et apostolicam benedictionem. Totum Domini gregem per quam diligenter moderari conantes, aptos volumus singulis ecclesialibus, communitatibus tribure pastores et veritates, de verbo quod caro factum est, diligentes precones. Quando quidem diocesis Bacolodensis, post renunciationem venerabilis fratris, Vincenzi Macana Navara, suo caret episcopo, nos dete, venerabilis frater cogitavimus. Tu enim in diocesi Cabancalensi humanas spiritualesque demonstrasti dotes nec non in provincia administrationes facultates. Ideo apostolica nostra potestate te, vinculo prioris ecclesiae solutum, Diocesis Bacolodensis constituimus episcopum, debitis datis iuribus congruisque impositis obligationibus. Et oceas clerum et Christi fideles pastorali tue cure con creditus hoc de nostro decreto, quos omnes ad ortamur ut te moderante diligentiore usque modo divina precepta in vita quotidiana servent, vivam Christi in mundo presentiam manifestantes. confidimus fore ut tu ipse episcopali diligente ministerium multum in spiritalem progressionem fidelium tuorum conferas, magistro divino semper confidens et eius beatissime matri. Nos met ipsi tibi venerabilis frater spiritalia efflagitamus adjumenta ut tuam ecclesialem communitatem, sive verbo Dei, sive eucharistico convivio alere valeas. Datum Rome apud Sanctum Petrum, die quarto et vicesimo mensis Mai, in memoria beate Maria, Mariae, Virginis Auxilii Christianorum, anno Domini bis millesimo sexto decimo, jubileo misericordiae, pontificatus nostri quarto, Franciscus. Francis, Bishop, servant of the servants of God, to the Venerable Brother Patricio Abelia Buzon, until now Bishop of Kabangkalan, now chosen for service as Bishop of the Diocese of Bacolod, greetings and apostolic blessing. Gravely solicitous to shepherd the whole flock, we see the need to provide suitably the local churches with worthy pastors and heralds of the truth of the Word made flesh. Since after the retirement of our Venerable Brother Vicente Macana Navarra, the Diocese of Bacolod is without a bishop, we have thought about you, Venerable Brother. For when you were in the Diocese of Kabangkalan, you have shown not only human and spiritual qualities, but also endowed as you are with abilities in the realm of administration. Therefore, by our apostolic authority, we release you from the bonds of the former diocese and appoint you Bishop of the Diocese of Bacolod, conferring and imposing upon you all the rights and obligations thereof. Instruct the clergy and the faithful entrusted to your care on this our decree, all of whom we exhort under your direction to be faithful to the divine precepts in their daily lives to make manifest the living presence of Christ in the world. We are firmly confident that your diligent exercise of your episcopal ministry will do much to advance the spiritual growth of the faithful committed to your care, trusting always in the Divine Master and His most blessed Mother. We ourselves earnestly assure you of our spiritual support, Venerable Brother, so that you may steadily nourish the church community with the Word of God and the Eucharistic banquet, given in Rome at St. Peter's, this 24th day of the month of May, on the feast of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Help of Christians, in the year of our Lord 2016, the Jubilee Year of Mercy, the fourth of our pontificate.
Magpamalakpak kita bilang tanda sa aton pagpasalamat. Karon si Archbishop Villegas magatindog sa atubangan sang aton bag-o nga senior obispo para sa pagpangamuyo. Tapos ang pangamuyo, ang Archbishop magatoy-toy sa aton bag-o nga senior obispo sa iya pulungkuan, ang katedra. Sa wala pa makalingkod ang aton bag-o nga senior obispo, si Archbishop Villegas magapahayag sa mga pulong sang instalasyon ni Most Reverend Patricio Buzon. Tapos ang sini nga mga pulong, ang aton bag-o nga senior obispo magapungko sa katedra. Kung sa diin, siya magabaton gikan sa arsobispo sang crozier o kung bakulo, tanda sang pagtugyan sa iya sang buluhaton sang isa ka manugbantay sang katauhan sang Dios bilang bag-o nga senior obispo sang diocese sang Bacolod.
Almighty and eternal God, from the highest heavens you sent your Son among us to teach us and guide us. We earnestly pray that this your servant Patricio, in whom you have given the fullness of the priesthood, may grow in humility as he approaches the chair of his office. Let him come among us as one who serves and make his heart the throne of your comforting spirit. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the name of God, by the authority vested in me, I, Socrates Villegas, Archbishop of Lingayen Dagupan, and President of the Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines, and presider of this canonical installation, do install you, Patricia Buzon, Bishop in this Church of Bacolod. May our Lord Jesus Christ guard your going in from henceforth, now and forever.
Amen.
The Holy Father, Pope Francis, has chosen you to be the shepherd of the people of the Church of Bacolod. With prayerful confidence and trust, I hand to you the crozier as a sign of the shepherd's office. May the Lord sustain you as you watch over the flock of this diocese to which the Spirit has assigned you as bishop to serve this Church of God.
With faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, and with love of God in my heart, I accept the pastoral care of the people of God in the Diocese of Bacolod. I resolve to serve faithfully the Church in this diocese.
Tanda sa pagbaton sang bugos nga diocese sang Bacolod, bilang mga representante sang bugos nga katawan sang Diyos, ang mga masunod magahatag sang hila, homage sa aton bag-o nga senior obispo. Una, ang bugos nga kaparian sang Diocese sang Bacolod, mga superior kag superiora sa mga relihiyoso nga kongregasyon nga mga lalaki kag babaye, mga representante sa mga papal awardees, lay associations, civic leaders kag pila ka mga sectoral groups. Pagkatapos ining paghatag sang homage, ang Santos nga misa magapadayon sa kinaandan.
Thank you. glorious lamb, shining the torch of faith in your hand.
Oh, Chelsea's day.
Oh.
us pray. God, shepherd and ruler of all the faithful, look favorably on your humble servant, whom you have set at the head of your church of Bacolod as her shepherd. Grant, we pray, that by the word and example, I may be of service to those over whom I preside, so that together with the flock entrusted to my care, I may come to everlasting life through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. Palihog maglingkod ang tanan.
Ang pagbasa gikan sa libro sa Deuteronomio. Sa sini nga adlaw, ginpapili ko kamo sa kauswagan kag kalaglagan, ukon kabuhi kag kamatayon. Kun tumano ninyo ang sugo sang Ginoo nga inyo Dios, nga akon ginahatag sa inyo sini nga adlaw, kun ginahigugma ninyo siya, tumana ninyo siya. Kaghimua ang tanan niya ng mga kasuguan. Dayon magauswag kamo, kagmangin isa kapungsod, nga madamo ng mga tao. Ang Ginoo nga inyo Diyos, magabendisyon sa inyo duta, nga madali na lang ninyo panag-iyahan. Ginapapili ko kamo karon sa kabuhi ukon kamatayon. Sa pagkamaayo, ukon sa pagkamalaot sa Diyos, kagsaksi ko ang langit kagduta sa inyo pagapilion. Pilia ang kabuhi, higugmaa ang Ginoo nga inyo Diyos, tumana siya kag magmatutom kamo sa iya. Agod nga kamo kag ang inyo mga kaliwat, magakabuhi sing malawi, sa duta nga iya ginsaad, nga ihatag sa inyo mga katigulangan, nga amo sanday Abraham, Isaak, kag Jacob. Ang pulong sang Diyos.
Thank you. ang pagbasa gikan sa nahauna nga sulat ni San Pablo nga apostol sa mga taga Korinto. Pero matuod gid nga si Kristo ginbanhaw gikan sa minatay. Kag siya amo ang garantiya nga ang mga minatay pagabanhawon man. Kay subong nga ang kamatayon nagabot paagi sa isa ka tawo, sa amo man nga bagay ang pagkabanhaw gikan sa kamatayon magaabot paagi sa isa ka tawo. Kay subong nga ang tanan nga mga tawo nagkalamatay tungod sang ila kaangtanan kay Adan, sa amo man nga bagay ang tanan pagabanhawon tungod sang ila kaangtanan kay Kristo. Pero ang tanan pagabanhawon sing pasunod, nahauna si Kristo, kag ang madason amo sila nga iya ni Kristo sa tion sang iya pag-abot. Dayon ang katapusan mag-aabot. Si Kristo magadaog sang tanan nga espirituhanon nga mga kagamhanan, mga otoridad, kag magahom, kag itugyan niya ang ginharian sa Dios nga Amay. Kay kinahanglan nga si Kristo maghari, tubtob malutos ang Dios ang tanan nga mga kaaway, kag mabutang niya sa sila sa idalom sang iya mga tiil. Ang katapusan nga kaaway, kag pagadagon, amo ang kamatayon. Pero kung mabutang na ang tanan sa idalom sang pagahom ni Kristo, ti ang anak mismo magapasakop sang iya kaugalingon sa Dios, nga nagbutang sang tanan sa idalom niya. Dayon ang Dios magagahom sing bugos sa tanan. Ang pulong sang Dios
salamat sa Dios.
Jesus proclaimed the gospel of the kingdom and cured every disease among the people.
Hallelujah!
When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and went to live in Capernaum by the sea, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali, that what had been said through Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way to the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who sit in darkness have seen a great light. On those dwelling in a land overshadowed by death, light has arisen. From that time on, Jesus began to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." He went around all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and curing every disease and illness among the people. His fame spread to all of Syria, and they brought to him all who were sick with various diseases and racked with pain. Those who were possessed, lunatics and paralytics, and he cured them. And great crowds from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, and Judea, and from beyond the Jordan, followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, 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 alleluia,
His Excellency, Most Reverend Socrates B. Villegas, CBCP President and Archbishop of Lingayen Dakupan, His Excellency, Most Reverend Vicente Navarra, Bishop Emeritus of Bacolod, and my beloved predecessor the second time over. My brother, Archbishops and Bishops of the Philippines, Monsignor Crispin and Monsignor Arnaldo, who came to represent our Papal Nuncio, Archbishop Giuseppe Pinto, honorable government officials from both the province and the cities and municipalities of our diocese, Reverend Monsignori, brother priests, deacons, religious brothers and sisters, seminarians, beloved people of God. Maayo nga aga sa atong nga tanan. One of the first call I had on the evening of my official announcement as new Bishop of Bacolod was from Miss Carla Gomez of Visayan Daily Star. After some congratulatory words, she asked, "Bishop, what is your reaction about your appointment?" I paused a few seconds and then responded, humbled. For indeed, many thoughts and feelings filled my heart then, but what prevailed was an uneasy sense of inadequacy. Knowing myself well, I was overwhelmed by the thought that I was being assigned to a diocese of priests and lay faithful of high intelligence, exceptional capacity, and enormous resources. I could only echo the words of Solomon when the Lord appeared to him in a dream and make his prayer my own. Yahweh, my God, give your servant a heart to understand how to govern your people, how to discern good and evil. For how could one otherwise govern such a great people of yours? In the same interview, Ms. Gomez followed her first question with another. What are your plans for the diocese? This time, my answer was quick. None. I said, I have no plans. But I do have one wish for our diocese. That the kingdom of God may come among us. And that is why I have taken as my motto what Jesus asks of the Father in the prayer he taught us. Adveniat regnum tuum. Thy kingdom come. What is the kingdom of God? When we hear the word kingdom, what immediately comes to our mind is all the glitter and glamour of the court with all its riches and power. The kingdom of God announced by Christ is anything but this. In fact, he tells us that the kingdom of God belongs to the poor, the children, and even sinners. As we have heard in the gospel just read to us, Jesus proclaimed the kingdom of God when he began his ministry. His message inspired many people to follow him in the hope of a better life. Once after he multiplied bread to feed a crowd of 5,000, the people wanted to make him king. He did not deny that he is king, but his kingdom is not an earthly or political kingdom. He made this clear to Pilate when he said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my men would have fought to prevent my being surrendered to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom does not belong here." The kingdom proclaimed by Jesus has always been misunderstood from the beginning, not only by the people who followed him, but even by those who were closest to him, his apostles. No wonder there was much bickering and arguing among themselves about who was the greatest. There was much lobbying and positioning on who would sit at his right or at his left. Right to the end, just as Jesus was about to return to his Father in heaven, they still hoped for the return of the Davidic dynasty. And their last words to Jesus was, "Lord, has the time come for you to restore the kingdom of Israel?" This hope persists even to this day. The temptation to build a kingdom other than that of God has always been in the church. We see how throughout her long history, the church struggled with the temptation to power and at times succumbed to it. And it was when she was most powerful that she was most impoverished in her life of the Spirit and in her ministry. Today, the same temptation continues to present itself to us. That is why, in the light of the present events, many lament that the church has lost its influence and political clout. Many even question whether the church is still relevant in the post-EDSA society. Today, we see not only a powerless church, but a church humbled and even mocked. Rightly does our CBCP President, Archbishop Sok, describe our present situation as being in the wilderness, where the temptation to change stone into bread is almost irresistible. But he tells us, we are in the wilderness, and the wilderness is for purification and prayer. It is a call for returning to the basics. From his message to us at the 113th CBCP Plenary Assembly last July. Some years ago, in the wake of the Hello Garcia controversy, the nation was thrown into a political crisis. Politicians were frantically jumping from one party to another as the Gloria Resign movement was fast gaining ground. Everyone believed that an EDSA 4 was in the offing. All that was needed was a tipping point for an imminent downfall of government. And their hope was that a pastoral statement from the bishops who were then gathered at the Pope Pius XII Catholic Center for their semi-annual plenary assembly would provide such final game changer. I can still vividly remember the face of Archbishop Franco, our papal nuncio then, as he gave his opening message. Midway through his speech, he put aside his prepared text and extemporized. He opened his heart and said, "There is a perception that the church in the Philippines is powerful, that the bishops can make and unmake governments." He paused, looked at us, and then continued, "It's a shame. The church is not a power broker. She has no power except the power of the cross. The more powerless the church, the more credible and effective she becomes in fulfilling her mission of evangelization. The more powerless the church, the freer she is in exercising her prophetic role of standing up for what is right, of denouncing what is evil and unjust, of defending life and family, of protecting the weak and the poor. The church has no power but the power of Christ on the cross, who said, 'And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself.'" And so, coming back to our original question, what is the kingdom of God? I answered this last night during our Vespers. The kingdom of God is where God is king, where he rules, where he is obeyed. In the Lord's Prayer, the petition, "Thy kingdom come," is immediately followed by the petition, "Thy will be done." They are the same petition. "Thy kingdom come" means "Thy will be done." I was telling the congregation last night that I wish I had the same energy as I had 13 years ago. I know I am growing older because I can feel it in my bones and in my joints. The older I grow, the more I realize that in life, there are really only two choices to make. And we heard this in the first reading. "I put before you two choices, a blessing or a curse, life or death. Choose life." And it's true in life. At every step of life, when we make choices, there are really only two choices, life or death. More specifically, God or myself. His plan or my plan? His will or my will? Even right now, I can see it in my ministry. Right now, I can either preach Christ or preach myself. I can either promote the glory of God or glorify myself and try to impress you. I can either build God's kingdom or my kingdom. And oftentimes, the distinction is so unclear. If I decide to choose God, I must choose to die. To die to myself. If I choose to allow God to enter and rule my life, I must empty my heart of self and give up all control to Him. I said earlier that I have no plans for the diocese. Any plan for the diocese will come from all of us. That is why I intend to spend the first 100 days visiting all our parishes and talking to every one of our priests and lay leaders. Then we shall meet as a presbyterium, as a diocese, and together craft our plan. What plan will it be? I don't know. It depends on us, on all of us. But two things I know. I know where God wants us to go and where God wants us to start. What God wants for our diocese is that He reigns in our diocese, that His kingdom come upon us. And the coming of God's kingdom starts with conversion. We heard it in the gospel when He announced the coming of the kingdom. Repent. The kingdom of God is close at hand. Jesus precedes the proclamation of the coming of the kingdom with a call to conversion. And interestingly, He also accompanies His preaching of the kingdom with the healing of the sick and the casting out of demons. Healing and exorcism are prerequisite for the coming of the kingdom. They are the unmistakable signs that God is present and that God rules. Healing is restoring wholeness in a person, not only putting back in order the relationship between body and spirit, but all relationships, his relationship with his God and with his brethren. A number of you have come to me even before I came here, and I've talked also with many of you on the few occasions that I came here. And I'm struck by what many of you expressed to me as your deepest hope for our diocese, namely, healing. Healing within and among our clergy and our lay people. We need to start with healing among ourselves. The second thing we need to do to start welcoming the kingdom of God among us is exorcism. We need to exorcise our diocese. In Kabangkalan, once we thought of having also one of our priests as a special minister of exorcism. And so we approached one of our priests and said, "Father, are you willing to take up the ministry of exorcism? We will send you to Manila. There are exorcists there. You can go to some training." Kabalo kamo ano yung sabat? Nga mangita pa kamo sang away sa yawa. Kadamo na sang alawayunda. Ara ang PPC, ara ang Finance Council, ala ang sakristan, ara ang obispo. Nga mangita pa sang away aw. He said, why do you pick up a quarrel with the devil? There are too many people already to quarrel with. There's the PPC and PPCRV, and there is the finance committee and the sacristan, even the bishop. My point naman siya, he is one of our wisest priests, but his wisdom is his own. True, he has a point. We don't need to cast out demons. We need to cast out many other occupants equally destructive and prohibitive, forbidding of God's kingdom and reigning in our life. When our heart is full of ego and self-interest, there is no space for God or His kingdom. The call for self-emptying is a call for all of us, starting with us in the leadership, with the bishop, with our priests. This means taking our priestly commitment to configure our lives to Christ seriously and purging our ministry of every trace of clericalism or entitlement. The arrogant culture of ang pari hari has no place in the kingdom because God alone is king. And for you, dear lay faithful, it means taking your Christian vocation seriously and rooting out whatever is unchrist-like in your life. Only then can there be space for God to reign in your hearts, in your homes, in your workplaces, in business, in government, in public office. In this regard, the diocese counts much on you. You lay people make up 99.99% of the church, whose mission is to proclaim and build God's kingdom in the world that is fast becoming more and more secularized. I have read the acts and decrees of your Second Diocesan Synod. I was deeply impressed by the document's strong sense of social realities. Several times it mentions the need for social renewal and social transformation. There is even a whole chapter that deals with the church and its involvement in politics. This is your dream. This is our dream. The transformation of society, the renewal of society. But let us start well. The social transformation starts with our personal conversion. All your hopes and aspirations expressed in the Synod are precisely what the kingdom of God is about. Your dreams are God's own dream for our diocese, as beautifully sung by the choir during the procession of who make up our diocese coming up here, paying respect to the new bishop. A kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love, and peace. Our Blessed Mother is the perfect embodiment of the kingdom of God. When she learned from the angel the plan of God for her, she responded with, "Behold the handmaid of the Lord. Be it done to me according to your word." May she teach and guide us how to welcome God's kingdom in our life and in our diocese. And before closing, allow me to express my deep and sincere thanks to all of you. To our beloved Holy Father, Pope Francis, for his trust in appointing me and assigning me to this great diocese of Bacolod. To our Papal Nuncio, Archbishop Giuseppe Pinto, for being instrumental in my appointment And though sadly he cannot be here because of health reasons, he is represented by his secretaries, Monsignor Crispim and Monsignor Alnaldo. To my dear predecessor, Bishop Vicente Navarra, for the great legacy of a vibrant diocese you are now passing on to me. To our dear CBCP President, thank you, Bishop Sok, for the very, very uplifting and kind words you gave us at the start of this Mass. And thank you also for kindly installing me into this diocese. To my brother, bishops, archbishops and bishops of the Philippines, thank you for coming. Your fraternal presence and support means a lot to me. To all the priests, religious, seminarians who have come from different dioceses, to my brother Salesians and the Salesian family from both the North and South provinces, to my family who are here, my brothers and their families, my relatives, friends, my former students who have come from far and near, and to all of you who have come to attend my installation and to pray for me. In a special way, I would like to thank my former diocese, the Diocese of Kabangkalan, for lovingly accepting me as your bishop and father for the past 13 years. As I said in my last letter, I began my ministry with a sincere desire to bring God's love to you, as expressed in my motto, Amorem Dei Ferens, carrying God's love. In the end, it was you who brought the love of God to me, and in such great abundance. In particular, I thank our dear priests of Kabangkalan. You have taught me how to be human and how to be a bishop. Finally, I would like to thank the whole Diocese of Bacolod for your exceedingly warm welcome and kind acceptance of me. The welcome from Hinigaran right up to here in the cathedral was just so overwhelming, truly humbling. At the start of the preparations, I asked that my installation be kept simple, but I was told that the diocese wants to give me the best welcome and that Bishop Navarra himself personally oversees through the preparation. I would like, therefore, to express my deepest appreciation and sincerest thanks to you, dear Bishop Navarra, and to the preparations committee for all the work and the love you put in preparing for my coming and in organizing my installation. And to you all, our priests and lay faithful of the Diocese of Bacolod, I eagerly look forward to meeting each and every one of you and journeying with you together towards the full coming of God's kingdom in our beloved Diocese of Bacolod. Thank you very much, and God bless us all.
Paliog magtindog ang tanan.
Thank you.
Nagkatuwa ko sa isa lamang ka Diyos, amay nga magkagagahong sang tanan, magbubuhat sang langit kag sang duta, sang tanan nga mga nakita pag hindi makita. Nagatuwa ko sa isa ka Diyos at kaginoo nga si Jesu Kristo, bugtong nga anak sang Diyos, naging anak sang amay sa wala pa ang kalibutan. Diyos gikan sa Diyos, kasanag gikan sa kasanag. Diyos nga matuod gikan sa Diyos nga matuod. Ginanak siya, wala gintuga, isa sang kinag-ugali sa amay. Pagi sa iya ang tanan gintuga, tungod sa aton nga mga tao, at tungod sa aton kaluwasan, nanaog siya gikan sa langit. Kaginpanampon siya ni Maria nga Birhen sa lalang sang Espiritu Santo, kag nahimo nga tao. Inlansan siya sa krus, tungod sa aton, sa sugo ni Ponce Pilato, nagantos kaginlubong, kag nabanhaw siya sa ikatlo kaadlaw, suno sa kasulatan, kag nagkayab sa langit, naglingkod sa tuosang amay, kag magkarisya liwat na mahimayaon, sa paghukom sa mga buhi, kag sa mga minatay, kag ang iya ginharian, wala sing katapusan. Nagatuwa ko sa Espiritu Santo ang Ginoo kag magbubuhi nga nagikan sa amay kag sa anak upod sa amay kag sa anak ginasimba kag ginahimaya siya sing tingog. Naghambal siya paagi sa mga propeta. Nagatuwa ko sa simbahan nga isa santa katolika kag apostolika. Nagatuwa ko sa isa lamang kabunyag sa kapatawaran sang mga sala. Nagapaabot man ako sang pagkabanhaw sang mga minatay, kag sang pagkabuhi nga wala sing katapusan. Amen. Put sa bugos nga Santa Iglesia, mga muyo kita, mga utod, sa aton makagagahong na Diyos, nabugusan niya kita bilang isa kakatilingban sa himpit, kagmatuod-tuod nga gugma, kagpagbago. Sa tagsan naton kapag ampo magsabat kita, payusaha kami sa imong gugma o Ginoo.
Payusaha kami sa imong gugma o Ginoo.
Pahiusaha kami o Ginoo bilang isa ka simbahan upod sa amon Santo Papa Francisco, sa amon obispo nga si Patricio, kag sa tanan nga kaparian agud manginhanda kag bukas kami sa pagpatubo sa amon tagipusoon sang bag-o nga binhi sang pagtuo, paglaom kag paghigugma, agod amon maagom ang tunay nga pag-ayos sang mga pilas sang pagbinahinbahin, ilabi na sa sining ekstraordinaryo nga jubilyo sang kaluoy, mga muyo kita.
Pahiusaha kami sa imo gugma o Ginoo.
Pahiusaha kami o Ginoo upod sa mga lideres sang amon pungsod, agod sila man maghimakas sa pagtibong sang matuod nga hustisya kag paghidait para sa pagbag-o sang amon sosyedad. Mga muyo kita.
Pahiusaha kami sa imo gugma o Ginoo.
Pahiusaha kami, o Ginoo, upod sa mga katapo sang amon parokya, mga Kristiyanong katilingban, kag mga panimalay, agun mangin aktibo kaguhi kami nga mga katapo sang imo simbahan, diri sa amon diocese, kag sa pagbantala sang maayong balita, sang ginharian sang Diyos, paagi sa amon buhat, ilabi na sa amon pagsaulog, sang tuig, sang Eukaristiya, kag panimalay. Mga muyo kita.
Pahiusaha kami sa imo gugma o Ginoo.
Pahiusaha kami o Ginoo, bilang simbahan sang mga kubos, agod amon tamdon ang amon mga kauturan, nga biktima sang kaimulon, pagpamigos kag inhustisya. Kagagod mahatagan sila sang bagong atingog sa sining katilingban. Mga muyo kita.
Pahiusaha kami sa imong gugma o Ginoo.
Pahiusaha kami o Ginoo, upod sa amon bagong nga Senyor Obispo, Most Reverend Patricio Buzon, katagamusya sang dugang nga kusog, kabakod, kagkaalam sa pagdumala sining amon diocesis, pagimua kami nga mangin isa sa iya, mga handom ka mga pangamuyo, mga muyo kita.
Pahiusaha kami sa imo gugma o Ginoo.
Bugusa kami o Ginoo sa himpit kag matutuod nga gugma kag pagtuo. Agud bilang mga panong, manginisa kami sa pagbalay sang amon handom para sa pagbag-o sang imo simbahan. Ikaw nga nagakabuhi kag nagahari sa tanan nga mga tuig sang mga katuigan.
Amen. Paliog maglingkod ang tanan.
Thank you.
pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
May this oblation, O Lord, which we have presented for your humble servant, become an offering acceptable to you and for the good of the flock. May I, whom you have raised up among your people to be high priest, be endowed by your gift with apostolic virtues through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For by the anointing of the Holy Spirit you made your only begotten Son, High Priest of the new and eternal covenant, and by your wondrous design you were pleased to decree that his one priesthood should continue in the church. For Christ not only adorns with a royal priesthood the people he has made his own, but with the brother's kindness he also chooses men to become sharers in his sacred ministry through the laying on of hands. They are to renew in his name the sacrifice of human redemption, to set before your children the paschal banquet, to lead your holy people in charity, to nourish them with the word and strengthen them with the sacraments. And as they give up their lives for you and for the salvation of their brothers and sisters, they strive to be conformed to the image of Christ himself and offer you a constant witness of faith and love. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as an exaltation we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness, make holy therefore these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." mystery of faith.
Palihog magtindo ka.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Patricia, our Bishop, and all the clergy.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, with Saint Sebastian, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say.
Oh,
us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Kaliog magtindog ang tanan.
Let us pray. By the power of this sacrament, O Lord, increase the gifts of your grace in your humble servant, that I may serve you worthily in the pastoral ministry and receive the eternal rewards of a faithful steward. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Paliog maglingkod ang tanan. Karon magapamati kita sa mga mensahe gikan sa aton Bishop Emeritus, Most Reverend Vicente Navarra, kag sa mensahe sang Apostolic Nuncio, Most Reverend Giuseppe Pinto, nga pagabasaon sa iya First Secretary, Monsignor Arnaldo Catalan. After the said messages, the concluding rite will follow. After the Mass, we invite all the bishops to please stay for the pictorial. Thank you.
Archbishop Socrates Villegas, President of the Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines, the Honorable Vice Governor of Negros Occidental, Vice Governor Pong Lacson, the Honorable City Mayor of Bacolod, Mayor Evelio Leonardia, our newly installed Bishop of Bacolod, Bishop Patricio Abelia Buson, his family and guests, the Honorable Ambassador to the Vatican, Tita De Villa, the Secretaries of the Papal Nuncio, Monsignors Arnaldo Catalan and Crispin Dubiel, the Archbishops and Bishops of the Philippines, distinguished papal honorees, distinguished sponsors and benefactors, Reverend Monsignors and Fathers, diocesan and religious, Reverend Brothers, Reverend Sisters, the chairmen and members of the Executive Committee and of the different committees of the installation events and ceremonies, our delegates from the different parishes and Catholic schools of Bacolod Diocese, delegates from Kabangkalan Diocese, dear seminarians, brothers and sisters in Christ, maayong udto sa inyong atanan. I thank the Holy Father, Pope Francis, on his spirit-led choice of appointing Bishop Patricio Abelia Buson as the sixth residential and ordinary bishop of the Diocese of Bacolod. Let's give him a big hand, please. Thank you. I also thank our Papal Nuncio, Archbishop Giuseppe Pinto, to his secretary envoys, Monsignors Arnaldo Catalan and Crispin Dubiel, for recommending to the Holy Father the most suited candidate after a thorough and conscientious consultation. When I turned 75, 3 years ago, I tendered my resignation to the Holy Father in Rome. The Holy Father answered, I have to wait and to stay put until my successor is appointed. Thank God, after 2 years of prayerful waiting, my successor is appointed. Congratulate me naman. Thank you. Now, I believe the Diocese of Bacolod is one with me in saying we have at last in our midst one who is chosen by God for us, one who deserves all the obedience and respect, all the cooperation and support, all the loyalty and love of the clergy, diocesan and the religious, and of the lay faithful of the Diocese of Bacolod, including our religious sisters. It is common knowledge that Bishop Pat succeeded me as Bishop of Kabangkalan, and now he succeeds me as the sixth Bishop of Bacolod. May nagsiling, ah, kun amo, agud ba obispo ka sa Bacolod, obispo ka alay sa Kabangkalan. But you know, this is how God works. Yes, He works in so many wonderful ways we cannot understand. But it is according to His will, adveniat regnum tuum. Bishop Buzon, a while ago, the priests, diocesan and religious, the representatives of the Negros Occidental Women Religious Association, or NAURA, the lay faithful, representatives of the different religious organizations and movements, and the basic ecclesial communities, together with the high-ranking officials of the province, the cities, and the towns, as well as the military officials within the circumscription of the Diocese of Bacolod, all of them paid homage to you. As I was looking at them, their respectful kiss to your episcopal ring, their warm abrazos, may biso-biso pa, their strong handshakes with smiles on their faces, simply attest that deep in their hearts, they want to know you more and better. They want to be closer to you and to be sincere about it. May aragid man nga mga katahap, may mga pagpang tuta nga kakulba siguro, no? But at the same time, all over all of this, yaragid ang ila nga handom kagugma nga magpalapit sa imo, kag ikaw ang ila gadangpan, amay kag manugbulig. Bishop Pat, I assure you, they are all good-hearted people. Yes, they are not perfect, but deep in their hearts, a nobility of spirit is embedded such that they are always open to receive your advices and suggestions. They are open for dialogue and discussion. Yes, even for some needed admonitions. Bishop Pat, today I resign and retire, deeply grateful to the Lord that in His great love and mercy He has provided a good and understanding father, a wise and prudent teacher, a solicitous and caring shepherd of His flock, the Diocese of Bacolod, in your person, who is a great lover of people under His care, just like your patron saint, Saint John Bosco. My beloved people of the Diocese of Bacolod, our diocesan clergy, religious, and diocesan, dear sisters and lay faithful, I take this opportunity to thank all of you. Kapasalamat gid ako sa inyo tanan for all your kindness in accepting me and bearing with me as your bishop for the past 15 years man lang. I am deeply grateful for your prayers and cooperation as we lived and served together the Diocese of Bacolod despite ourselves. I say, dear brothers and sisters, friends all, They were all good years, memorable and grace-filled because of you. Dahil sa iyo. But I also beg your kindness to forgive and to forget whatever aches and pains I might have caused you one way or another. Finally, I say, behold your new bishop. Cherish him, love him, cooperate with him, support him, and never forget to pray for him. Madamo nga salamat sa inyong atanan.
The Apostolic Nuncio, Archbishop Giuseppe Pinto, really wanted to be with us this morning and share this experience, but for medical reasons was not able to attend. But he is spiritually with us in this message that I am pleased to share with you. To his relatives who were searching for Jesus, Jesus said, pointing to his disciples, "Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother, sister, and mother." This phrase of the Gospel of Matthew highlights that the greatness of the Mother of God lies above all in her unity and fidelity to God. His Excellency, Most Reverend Socrates Villegas, His Excellency, Most Reverend Patricio Buson, His Excellency, Most Reverend Vicente Navarra, Their Excellencies, the Archbishops and Bishops of the Philippines, Ambassador Davila, dignitaries of, and government officials, Reverend Fathers, religious brothers and sisters, dear seminarians, my brothers and sisters in Christ. The doors of this splendid cathedral open to welcome a new day, and with its new diocesan bishop, His Excellency Most Reverend Patricio Buson, nominated to the see by Pope Francis. It is a festive day, an event that manifests the love of God for his people, who sends them a wise and prudent pastor. On this occasion of his episcopal installation, I prepared an inaugural message following the indications of the Pastoral Directory for Bishops. Chapter 3 enumerated, among others, pastoral charity and pastoral prudence. I did not have any difficulty to compose a commentary. But the next theme was about obedience to the will of God, with only two explicatory phrases. Christ became obedient until death. Death on the cross. As I read the following pages, I almost heard a voice telling me, "Why do you need commentaries? Why do you distance yourself from Christ and his cross?" At that moment, I put aside the books, the commentaries, and even the internet, and followed the way of the heart. Some years ago, I asked the help of a priest friend to solve a real estate dispute. He was about to pronounce the inevitable no when he said, "Let's put ourselves in God's hands." Here is another story. One day, St. Peter asked the Lord for a leave to visit his relatives. He returned after nearly a week. "How are your loved ones?" the Lord asked. "All in good health," said St. Peter. "And do they remember me?" the Lord asked. Peter had to admit, "And it's not often that they prayed, and not even went to church. Only for weddings and funerals," he said. After a few months, St. Peter again left to visit his family and returned the next day. A bit sad, St. Peter informed the Lord that some of his family members were out of work and others were sick. "And do they ever remember me?" asked the Lord. "Oh, every day," came the reply. On the issue of loyalty, fidelity to God, we encounter in the story some characters, one who sought to bring union and peace, and others who were acting according only to their interests. What does it mean to be faithful to God? Of course, there is obedience to the commandments and norms of the church. But how can we know the will of God in our lives? Perhaps the corresponding reply is union with God. The merciful Father who embraces the prodigal son does not rejoice only for his return home, but for the relationship renewed, relationship of trust that is restored between him who had been lost and the one who was waiting to give him eternal life. So it was in the person of Jesus Christ, unity perfect between God and man, who in his death said to God, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." The sacrifice of Jesus and his return to heaven opened for us all the doors of paradise to everyone who has faith in God. Now we know the way, Jesus and the gospel. To do the will of God is to enter into the today of the gospel. Perhaps we are good listeners and viewers, but if we do not enter into the today of the gospel, we miss the point. This is why Pope Francis recommended taking the gospels with us, because it never gets old, but is waiting to bloom in us and with us, whether in and out of season. Allow me to wish Bishop Patricio, the priests and the seminarians, the lay ministers and the faithful of Bacolod to live in mutual trust, obedience, and in unity with the will of God. I reserve for the end a cordial greeting to His Excellency Monsignor Vicente Navarra, who, in leaving the office of Bishop of Bacolod after 15 years of ministry, I leave it now at this point later so that the applause is louder. Thank you. Thank you, dear Excellency, for having patiently waited for the new diocesan bishop for 2 years. God will reward you for this. May the loving intercession of Mary, the Mother of Christ, and the blessing of the Holy Father, Pope Francis, sustain you in every way.
After the Mass, may we also request all priests to kindly leave on your seats the vestments provided to you. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
May the Lord bless you and keep you.
Amen.
May He let His face shine upon you and show you His mercy.
Amen.
May He turn His countenance towards you and give you His peace.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. San Sebastian Cathedral to SM. Once again,